Good afternoon, Purple Nine Nation. My name is Malcolm Farrell, class of 2023. And today joining me, I have Dr. Walter Kimbrough. He is the author of Black Greek 101 and is the seventh president of Dillard University. And he is in the young average of an HBCU president and people at Dillard University and all around who know him, call him the hip hop prez. So thank you so much, Dr. Kimbrough, for joining us today.
All right, you're welcome.
So I just wanted to see, because I'm interested in knowing how Dillard's going through and your family, how you're dealing with COVID-19. So how are you and your family?
Oh, we're dealing with it like everybody else. I mean, it's, you know, it's been almost 8 weeks now, so you sort of get used to what this is like. So I think everybody's adjusted. Of course, you want to get back to doing things like you used to, but there's going to be some time before that happens. So.
Right. As president of a college, especially Dillard University, how is Dillard handling COVID-19 right now?
Well, so, I mean, we're almost done with our semester, which is good. Finals end this week. Seniors have already taken their finals. They're done. So for higher education, it was a lot easier for us than it was for K through 12 to go to online, because a lot of our students were already taking at least one online course. We have a platform that's already set up. So it was sort of easy when I compare with other, you know, educational institutions and just people in general. We had an ability to do this. So in that regard, it wasn't as disruptive. It was tough for some students because we get students from all across the country. So they're trying to decide, do I go home? If you have students who don't have good Wi-Fi in the house, you know, how do you do online work when you don't have access to Wi-Fi and Starbucks are closed and places like that with free Wi-Fi? So those were the things we had to try to help students out, help people get laptop computers if they didn't have have one. They could do a lot of work on their phones, but they still needed some other technology. So, I mean, we learned a lot going through the process, but, you know, things happen so quickly. You just have to sort of move with the punches. And I think people did a really good job just sort of accepting it for what it was and say, all right, let's go on and do this and do this. So I think it went well.
Okay. Has COVID-19 affected the admissions for the class of 2024?
So we don't know right now. Our numbers of admits and all that is, I think we're up a little bit from last year. Mm-hmm. So it's really, you won't know until August when we see what the impact is of the financial situation of the country. How many people have lost jobs or are not able to come to school. So as of right now, I mean, it looks like it'll be normal, but we know it won't be. So we just don't know what that's going to look like. And then for us on our campus, we have to figure out, like, you know, people want to live on campus. Well, rooms that were set up for two people now really have to be set up for one. Rooms that could accommodate three now would accommodate two. Classrooms that would normally, you know, be able to house or take 20 students, they need to be in a classroom that you would use for 50 students. So we have to do some shifting, which it's still okay. I mean, once again, we're a smaller institution and we can be nimble. So I think there are some advantages from that. If you're at a really big school and you have classes with 1,000 people in it, where do you move that class to? The stadium? That's not going to work. So they have a different, it's more difficult for them than it is for us. So those are the things that we just look at. So once we get through with graduation this week and everybody finishes finals, in the next 3 months, really, yeah, May, June, July, we'll be planning for the different options for fall. And we still don't know what that's going to look like. So we're working on different scenarios now.
Okay. So we're going to go from COVID-19 to, like, you as a president and how you feel that people should attend your school. So as president of an HBCU, do you feel that it's important that us as African Americans attend and support HBCUs, especially yours, Dillard University?
Well, so what I always tell students is, I think you need to go to the place that's the best fit for you. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, what people don't understand is that a big brand name state institution is not the best fit for you. But people get it hyped up in their head, like, "Ooh, I want to go to such and such because they have a big football program." I mean, I went to the University of Georgia, mm-hmm. and a lot of Black students who went to Georgia when I went, either they graduated, those that didn't, nobody knew anything about them, didn't care about them. I mean, you're on your own, and it's like that now. And you're still dealing with some of the racism that I saw as a college student 30 years ago. It's just as bad today. So you, if you go to a school like that, you need to understand, this is what I'm bargaining for. I'm going for this, this, and this. Now, if that's good for you and you're okay with that, my high school in Atlanta was 99% black. So I wanted a completely different experience. So I need to go to Georgia. I got my master's at Miami University in Ohio, where I could go the whole day and not see anybody else black. I love that place. But that was, for me, at that point in my life, that kind of experience was okay for me. What the problem I see is that there are too many black students that are being ushered to schools that are not HBCUs, and those schools are not a good fit for them. So if people would just go to the places that were the best fit for them, more people would go to HBCU. So I don't have to say, go to an HBCU. If I say go to the best fit and you go to the best fit, more people will go to HBCUs. And so that's the way that I look at it. That's the same thing for Dillard. You know, if you want to, you know, go into something that I don't have any way to really get you connected in, I'm like, oh, we're probably not the best place. I mean, if you know you want to go directly into engineering, I'd be like, well, we don't do directly engineering. Now, we do have one of the best physics programs in the country, number two in producing African-Americans with physics degrees. And a lot of those folks will go into engineering. So if you're interested in physics, there can be a way to do it. But if you just, you know, from the beginning, like, I just want to do engineering, I'm going to say, well, if you want to go directly into engineering, that's not what I offer. Okay. But there are lots of different things that we do better than a lot of other institutions. And so I would say, yeah, if you want to do something in film, you know, there are very few schools that have film programs that actually are making movies. We're one of those. You're going to get a hands-on experience. Come to Dillard. You want to go to law school, we have a full-time pre-law advisor. We have students from all other schools trying to come to Dillard, use our resources. I was like, no, you need to use your pre-law advisor at your school, not use ours. So that's another thing. So those are the ways people have to look at it. You know, what kind of programs, the people there, are they connected to the students? You know, so you got to ask what kind of experience that you want. So I think for a lot of things, we are a really good fit for someone. So I want people here who want to be here. If it's not a good fit, don't come. That doesn't benefit anybody. You're miserable. We're miserable. So I think that's the honest way to talk about it. So once again, I always just say, if people would go to the best fit for them, more people would go to HBCU. And we know people are not going to the best fit because we're seeing fewer blacks who are getting degrees in like medicine and law, even though many more blacks are going to predominantly white institutions. So if they're going to so-called better institutions, why are fewer blacks in those fields? People are going to places that are not a good fit for them. So that's the argument that I always make to people.
Okay. So as a student who will be attending college in the next 3 years, do you see any effects from the coronavirus in the foreseeable future on aspects of higher education, such as instruction, enrollment, and or student life?
Short term, yes, until there's a vaccine, you're going to have just have some distancing. So people won't be able to interact like they normally would. I was just listening to a news report. They're trying to fast track all of that. So you really can't get to back to where it was until you really get a vaccine. So it's going to be different. But like I said, it's not just the college experience. It's going to be everything that we do. So that's not, to me, doesn't, you know, it doesn't single out colleges. It's everything. All aspects of our life will be different. Instruction, I think more people will do some distance education, but that's still not always the best for people. So there's a lot of research that says, particularly for students of color, there is a lot of value in terms of the relationships we have with the faculty member and the student being in the physical space. Just as a people, I think that we connect that way, and that's a part of our learning pedagogy, if you will. So, you know, we're trying to find ways to have hybrid where some of your part-time, your class can be online, but then part-time it's in person as well. It's just, I mean, we're still very connected. We're still in a relationship economy. So I think a lot of people are really trying to push students to say, do everything online. But if everything is online and you're in a class and you're taking an online class with people from all across the country, and there are 2,000-3,000 people in the class, that faculty member is never going to know you. They're never going to be able to write a recommendation for you. So a lot of things that you would get in that personal environment where you develop a relationship, you don't have any of that. All you have is a piece of paper. And that's not good. That's the part that scares me, that people will say, well, you know, it's not worth it. Let me just go get a degree online. That's all you will have is a degree. You won't have some of those practical experiences. You won't have leadership experiences through clubs and organizations. You won't have mentors. All you have is a piece of paper. And that's not good. So I like using technology. I think there's a role for it. But for a lot of people, that is not the end all be all. You've got to do some other things too.
So last question. As a Black man and in the average in your position, what advice do you have for Purple Knights that aspire to be in your shoes one day?
I always tell people, you just have to do the best as you move in your career. And I hear from people, I heard from a young man who just started graduate school last week, wants to be a president. And I was just like, well, you're still away from that. So it's like, what do you do? That can be the ultimate goal. But what are you doing until you get there? So I always try to tell people, you have to be excellent all along the way, because people who are excellent all along the way have the best shot of being like a college president. You just can't just say, well, let me just sort of get by, and then at a certain point in time, I'm going to be a president. It doesn't work like that. So I always just try to tell people, what are you doing with the jobs that you have at that moment in time, doing the best that you can, being excellent then? And I think, you know, having that kind of mindset is what works. So that's what I always try to tell people. Do the best of what you have, and then you build from that.
Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Kimber, for sitting down with me and for the Purple Knights who want to know information, because we have a lot of seniors that will be heading out from St. Augustine going to college. So thank you so much for sitting down with us today.
All right. You're welcome.
All right.